This is the lecture or discussion, and I'm happy for it to be a discussion, although obviously there's quite a few slides to get through for the last project in Pintos, which is the file system. So, like the Project 5 talk, we'll go through basically what the requirements are and some ideas about implementation, how you can approach certain problems, and where to look. So, virtual memory was, I imagine everybody found it challenging, but it did have the upside that it was mostly not there to start with. Project 6 is a little different in that there is a completely functioning file system, or maybe I should say incompletely functioning, but that means that you've got code to figure out and understand before you can really change it. So that's part of the difficulty of 6, is that you're altering the functionality of an existing subsystem as opposed to creating one from scratch. And so it's a little bit more constraining that way. You got more risk, I suppose, in changing the existing code. So anyway, I do want to also mention that you should ask before, or you should please ask before using late tokens on Project 6. Just because of the deadlines for getting grades done. But, you know, I say right now that I think we're probably behind enough that it will probably be okay to use late tokens on Project 6, but still, you should check with us because these aren't terribly difficult to grade, and because of the massive bunch of tests that the project runs on each submission. So, still talk to us and figure out whether or not it would be okay, and if so, how many tokens you'd like to use. Like, if you have all your tokens, then we might need to figure out whether or not that's feasible. Okay, so the initial file system. Files are contiguous extents, so we do continuous allocation like we talked about a couple of lectures ago. And files cannot grow. So basically, there's no appending, and that obviously is pretty constraining. You can do quite a bit with that, but not everything we'd like to do. There's only a single root directory, and the root directory only has up to 16 entries. So that's also pretty limited. Okay. File system can only be used by one kernel thread at a time, so you all have this global file system lock, I'm presuming, unless you've been crazy and decided to work on that already. But a global file system lock because the current file system is not reentrant, and that's one of the tasks that you'll have to tackle this project. Okay, implementation requirements. Extendable files that don't require contiguous space. So they should be, the requirement is some kind of multi-level indexed allocation. Okay, so that means that files are no longer required to be contiguous on disk. Directories that can grow to hold more file entries as needed, so no longer limited to 16 file entries. Hierarchies of directories, so directories containing directories, there will still be a root, but there will be other directories inside of that. And then the hard part is fast concurrent access from many kernel threads, and that's probably the most challenging bit of all of this. Once you get that nailed down, everything else is kind of tedious and annoying to get right because it's file system data structures, and anyone who's taken the database implementation class knows that those are not forgiving things to work with, but everything else is pretty straightforward once you get your concurrent access done. Okay, order of implementation. So you can guess that they would suggest do the concurrency first. File system buffer cache, because anybody who tries to design a system and then later make it concurrent can tell you firsthand that it is terrible to approach design problems that way. So it's best to think about these things from the very beginning, and so that's why the buffer cache is first on the list. Second would be extendable files. It's suggested that you use an ext2-like file layout with direct nodes, single indirect, and double indirect nodes. You are not required to, though, and so if you want to do something that's more uniform, that's great. It certainly won't bother me. There's a huge loophole. Some of you have noticed this in some of the assignments. You say, well, you don't have to do X, or you don't have to do Y. And when you look at how to do X or Y, you realize, wow, that's incredibly complicated. I don't want to have to deal with that. You do not have to worry about shrinking files. Files can only grow in Pintos. That simplifies life in a number of ways. So we'll talk about that when we get to that point in the discussion. Subdirectories, number three. Let me take this off the display for a moment. Subdirectories are basically special kinds of files. And so, for example, what you can do is in the entry for a particular thing, have something saying whether it's a file or a directory, and then you know how to interpret the inode that it points to. Okay, so that's one option, very common option for how people approach implementing subdirectories. Okay, not difficult. And then remaining miscellaneous items. Processes start needing a current directory so that you can tell, you know, you can start resolving relative paths and so forth. And then you have directory paths, all that kind of malarkey. Okay. And then read ahead and right behind is not actually that complicated. These, well, first of all, does not affect correctness. You can't really write tests for it, right, because it's a performance-related thing. And secondly, it actually isn't terribly difficult to implement anyway. So somebody could knock this out right away, you know, if you get pretty much after you get the file system buffer cache, you could knock that out right away if you wanted to. Yes, sir?
So the actual interacting with disk remains constrained to a single thread. You mean it can concurrent by basically buffering it in memory so you don't have to write to disk?
That is correct. So how much concurrency do you really have when it comes to the disk controller itself? And the answer is not much. It's not so much per disk. This is where it's a little bit unclear to me, because the way the IDE driver is written, I don't know if any of you have looked at it, but each channel has a lock guarding interactions with the devices on that channel. So if there are two devices, then it could mean interactions between swap and disk are serialized if they're on the same channel. But I looked at this 1 year and I can't remember what I decided or what I found, whether or not swap and the disk are on separate channels and therefore could occur concurrently. But yeah, disk interactions are always serialized. That will necessarily limit concurrency. And this gets back to the whole issue of DMA transfers. That's the way to make disk interactions concurrent. So you can queue them up, send them all out to the controller. The OS or the controller can order them based on trying to optimize disk seek times. And then you get a bunch of requests that are satisfied at once when the interrupt goes and you've got a whole bunch of disk transfers into memory. So that's an interesting thing. And the implication is exactly like you said. Concurrency emerges from having this buffer cache. Okay? So we have multiple readers can overlap, writers cannot overlap, but the fact that you're hitting memory instead of talking to the disk, and then you've got this cache that sits between everybody and the disk, that's what gives you a lot of concurrency in the situation. Any other questions regarding that? That's an interesting issue. And I'm not sure what all the implications will be. I don't think they mangle any of the things we discuss in here. I don't think there's anything that's really dependent on that aspect of things. But you may run into something specific about that. Okay, order of implementation. Let's see, I had something specific to say about this. Oh yeah, the assignment suggests that items 2 and 3 can be implemented in parallel. And the thing that you need to be aware of, especially since you can implement quite a number of these things in parallel, parallel does not mean isolated. And that is a really important thing. You're lucky you only have 2 to 3 people on your teams. So this is a relatively easy process to manage. But when you have multiple concurrent development efforts going on, you need to merge frequently, because these subsystems are interacting with each other, and especially you're going to be doing some of this stuff in the same files. Extendable files, so that's going to be requiring inode implementation. Subdirectories, that's also going to require inode interactions. So if you have two people coding on these two things, you need to be merging the changes frequently. Now, the other thing about this is working in parallel means that everybody's working. And if one person decides to commit something that just completely screws up everything else, well, now nobody's working. So you need to be really careful. This is where you require good engineering discipline, software engineering discipline. Okay, so just pay attention to this if you decide to pursue things concurrently. Okay. All right. Let's see, concurrent access. So basically, this is the whole issue of being able to interact with a particular file from multiple processes concurrently. Basically, the only constraints are file extension always needs to be atomic because otherwise you will completely mangle your files. And the other one is that readers shouldn't block each other. Those are basically the requirements. If you have writers to different parts of the file, it'd be really great if they're interleaved. Writers to the end of the file definitely should be serialized. Okay. Yeah, so like I say, this can be true on a per-sector basis. If you're doing like a real OS, then you might need to think about doing them on disk block units as opposed to per-sector units. You might have to think about per read-or-write units. Like Unix doesn't work that way, but it's completely feasible that someone might design a file system that, for example, made it easier to implement things like databases on top of it. And so you'd have to think about this more carefully. But in Pintos, we don't care about concurrent access in any sort of like, you know, really theoretically clean way. We just want writes to different parts of the file to not block each other. And reads should not see a partially written sector. Okay. Those are the requirements. This turns out to be pretty straightforward given the way the file cache tends to work, the design that people tend to take. Okay, directory operations on different directories should be concurrent. Okay, this is kind of an important one. We'll talk about why hopefully later. If we don't, then I'll make sure to mention that specifically. You definitely need to get rid of any global file system lock. You may not get rid of that right away, and we'll talk about how you might approach this momentarily. But you do need to make sure that you don't have anything limiting interactions with the file system to being always only serial, because if you do, then you'll have a massive deduction. Okay, I hate having massive deductions for things, but the whole point of this project, besides learning file systems, is that the requirements for concurrency are increasing. You may have noticed that we're getting more and more rigorous about what, how much can happen at once in these projects. And so it's a major aspect of this assignment that you be able to do concurrent interactions with the file system. Okay, so I'll show you a few examples of this as we go through. Okay, one thing that I will mention before we move on is that you may have global locks in one or two places. You just need to be really careful in how you interact with them that they don't prevent concurrent access. But there may be a few places, and I'll show you, where you want to have a global lock that everybody uses. Okay, file system cache. Straightforward to implement, he says. The main reason why it's pretty straightforward to implement is that it's kind of small and it's fixed size, so you don't need to worry about it being dynamic, really. 64 cache blocks is all the assignment requires of you. And it specifies it so you can statically allocate this thing. You can put it in your module variables, for example, declare it static so it's not visible outside of the file system cache, and then have operations that interact with the cache, just like you guys are familiar with from earlier assignments, I'm sure. Okay, so the assignment says you can exclude the free space map if you wish, but I haven't seen student implementations that really care one way or another. They tend to be agnostic about it and just do all the interactions from the free space map through the file cache as well. So it's really not that big a deal. But it's the same thing as always. You'll need a dirty bit to know if it's been written to so that when you evict, you know to write it back. Okay, you don't want to write it back if it's not dirty. The other thing about this is notice you will have eviction. You will have an eviction policy. And you probably need to keep track of what sector is loaded into each in-memory block. That's a pretty obvious one. Okay. Yes, sir?
When you say a cache block, is that a page?
In this context, you'll probably want to cache sectors. Sectors are 512 bytes in Pintos because 2004, 2005, I mean, people were thinking about 4K sector sizes, but they weren't really using them very much. So These blocks in this context are sectors. Yeah. Okay, any other questions? All right, let's see. One idea for an approach. I like this idea a lot. Maybe because it's my idea, but the idea is to build a file system cache with no concurrency yet. Okay? And so basically what you're doing is making sure that mapping lookups to blocks in the cache, or let's say sectors in the cache, works correctly. Make sure that writes against sectors in the cache work properly. Have like a random eviction policy that's synchronized so that when things are evicted, you can look to say, oh, it needs to be written back, so you write it back and blah, 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 blah. Okay? And make sure that tests pass. Okay? And to me, this is valuable because it gives you an indication that the parts that manage the data of the file cache work properly in isolation, right? They don't work properly concurrently yet, but at least you know that they'll work properly in isolation. So you know you're managing your hash table correctly or however you decide to do this. Yeah?
When you say all file system access has to go through the cache,
mm-hmm.
So if you only have 64 cache blocks, so say you have like 100 threads and they all are trying to write concurrently, then that would block, right?
Because
64 then would get sectors.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because if you have 64 blocks and let's say you have 100 kernel threads that are all trying to write, then you're definitely going to have some blocking. But ideally, if you satisfy the concurrency requirement properly, then you'll have, how shall we say, kernel threads will block only when they're either writing to a sector that's already being written by another kernel thread, or they will block because something's being evicted. But those are basically the reasons that they would block. It's feasible that different kernel threads writing would have their writes to different sectors occur in parallel, or let's say concurrently, because that's more accurate. And then you would only get contention when kernel threads are trying to write to the same sector or things are being evicted, which in your scenario would be happening a lot. So certainly that's a granted thing, but you should still see some concurrency in that example. Okay, what else do I want to say about this? Yeah, first thing that I'll say just about managing this stuff is that the solution, I haven't decided if I care enough about this to say anything, but the actual grading rubric from Stanford says, since there's only 64 blocks, if you do a linear search for the block holding a sector that you want, that's okay. There's no penalty for that. You could use a hash table. And I would probably use a hash table just because I would feel embarrassed as a programmer. Of course, I've been programming longer than some of you have been alive, so maybe that's the reason. But yeah, so you can use a hash table for this file system cache, but you do not have to. You could just use linear search. And it does, there are some simplifications to that approach. I'll try to mention those when we get to that. Okay? So anyway, let's say you build your cache, keep your concurrency limited, and then you go ahead and start doing per-entry read-write locking. Okay. So that way you haven't made a bunch of changes, you made some changes and verified them, and then you're making more changes, and then you start verifying those. Okay? Readers don't block readers, writers block everybody, make sure everybody still passes. And then, of course, this is always straightforward. What makes this stuff challenging is eviction. This is the same story as last time. So if you have other concurrency issues that start to emerge, then you can try to address those things as well. Okay? And then you could also consider when you start adding read ahead and write behind, that's another level of concurrency, and that may require revisiting some of this stuff. Yeah.
When you say per entry and read-write locking, that's per sector per file?
Yeah, that would be per sector. So the terminology I'm using so far I probably should define somewhere, but blocks in the file system cache store one sector, that's the terminology I'm using, and you want to support concurrent access on a per sector basis, and so the consequences of that is that each block will in all likelihood have a read-write block associated with it. That's certainly what the solution implementation does, and that's what just about every team does. So So if you come up with something really clever with multiple versions or something like that, then go you, but good luck. I think there's a lot of benefit in approaching the problem this way because you have to implement a read-write lock, so you can see how that works. There's several ways to do that, and it's a nice, straightforward way of implementing this kind of a problem. So I think it's a good thing to see once, be familiar with, and then you can try more sophisticated options later on if you ever encounter such a problem. Or in a CS81, which would also be an option. Okay, let's see. Next thing. So yeah, cache is statically allocated array of entries. As I mentioned, you could use a hash table to map stuff into that array. But you can also do a linear search. Okay. I also mentioned that entries will need a lock of some kind to coordinate access. You do need some kind of eviction policy. The assignment, again, says clock is the lower bound of implementation. Remember that clock is not timer-based. Even though it has clock in the name, you don't require a timer tick for this. So a lot of students do clock. A lot of students do LRU. LRU is not hard at this point because we're not implementing this in hardware anymore. Remember that when we talked about virtual memory, we said LRU is basically prohibitively expensive to implement because of the stuff that would have to be managed. But at this level, LRU is fine. And so you could try LRU and see how it behaves. Or you could do LRU2, which might even be better. I don't think there's any Pintos tests that exercise scanning. But remember that LRU is scan sensitive, and LRU2 is pretty dang scan resistant, is probably the best way to put it. All right. I would also say that I would not do a timer-based policy for these because of the fact that we're going to have read ahead and write behind implemented. Right behind will allow eviction to be cheaper, actually, because it will clean dirty entries in the file cache. Okay. So let's see. Blah, blah, blah. I'm going to throw this up here just because it's talked about in some documentation somewhere for Pintos, and I'm like, okay, I'll tell you guys, but I don't think this is that important. If you have file metadata, like your inode stuff, it's going to be accessed more. So anything you do that is based on access, you're going to see the metadata sticking around in memory a little bit longer. So to me, that's fine enough. But I don't know. I haven't implemented like 9 file systems, so maybe it's got a point. Anyway, so you can think about that. I would keep it simple. Okay, concurrent access. So process A wants to read sector 234. Let's say that you're using a hash table because you like the speed, but now your life is more complicated, and so it has to look up which entry contains the sector. Then process B decides that it wants to load sector 216. Now, this is an interesting one because these sector numbers are actually unique identifiers, and they're global across processes because everybody's accessing the same disk, and you do it with the logical block number from 0 all the way up to whatever the device size is. So in this case, it's conceivable that process A and process B may want to access sector 234, and they refer to the same sector. So this is different from virtual memory, you probably recall. So anyway, let's say that sector 234 was chosen for eviction. And so now we have this thing that two processes want to deal with the same sector, okay? So here's the thing. If you have a hash table, the hash table is not a concurrent modification hash table. The Pintos hash table is not sophisticated enough for that. So maybe you think, I need some kind of lock to guard this. And this is where you could either use a read-write lock, assuming that most of the accesses will be reads. That would be a fair approach, but then sometimes you are going to be modifying it, so you need to think about that instead. So, could a process get to a cache entry and then suddenly discover that the entry is not what they thought it was? This is the big one, and I would say many solutions that students choose could end up with a situation where you think this is going to be in block one, and it ends up not being there by the time you get to it. And you need to think about how to handle this scenario or if it can occur. Okay. Likelihood is that it probably can occur for your particular circumstance. Okay, let's see. Global mapping of sector numbers to file system entries. So here's the rundown, and this is actually, if you're thinking about this as we go through this, you should be asking yourself, can this occur if I just do linear scans through my cache? Because you'll find that linear scans actually don't really have this problem so much. Okay. So you have a hash map, mapping sector numbers to entries, a global lock used to guard the hash map, and you want to interact with a block in the cache. Well, you acquire the global lock, you find the block in the cache, you do your lookup against your hash table, you release the global, oh, I'm sorry, forgot a step. You acquire a lock on the block, okay, because you want to crab. I've got a lock here, I want to take a step, so I'm going to hold that lock before I let this lock go. And so you release the global lock after acquiring the block's lock, prefer my own the block, and then I'm done with the block, okay? That's like normal. This is like everybody should look at this and say, okay, that seems safe, that seems reasonable, and that would be a good conclusion to draw. Except that now you've actually greatly limited your concurrency in certain circumstances. This is the scenario, and I think this is actually straight out of the TA notes for this project. I wanted to share this because this is an important design detail to be aware of. So kernel thread 1 performs a read on block B. Kernel thread 2 decides to evict it, or like I say, do anything else, like maybe a write. Kernel thread 3 performs IO on anything else. Okay. You basically end up with this kind of interaction. So thread 1 gets the global lock, finds the block that it's looking for, acquires that block's lock, releases the global lock, and then starts reading data. So we know that this is going to block access to the device. Okay. So then kernel thread 2 acquires the global lock, find block B in cache, and then block on B's lock. Okay? The problem here is that kernel thread 2 holds the global lock guarding the hash table, and it's waiting for B's lock, but kernel thread 1 is holding B's lock because it's doing something slow to it. Okay? And since we've acquired B's lock and now we're talking to the device, we have to wait for the device to finish and come back to this kernel thread before we can release B's lock. And so kernel thread 3 down here blocks on the global lock. Okay, so it's subtle, but you've completely blown away your concurrency by being careful, right? So this is the challenge that we have. And so this is interesting little side note that I was mentioning before, is the whole issue here is we've got find block B in cache guarded with acquired global lock because we have this separate hash table that we're managing. If each block is got its own lock and you just search through them linearly, then, well, some problems go away. This problem goes away. But then you have another problem that can occur, which is, how do I know that I don't already have block B in cache? Because I could be scanning through and block B is up here and... let me do it this way. I'm scanning through, and another kernel thread evicts and loads that block after I've passed that point in my file system cache. So there's another issue you have to think about. Okay. So maybe you can't get away from having a global lock, but you'll have to think about that kind of stuff. All right, so here's the scenario. Yeah, so I already talked about this. Basically, the issue is that we hold the global lock until the entry lock's acquired, and sometimes there's other things doing slow stuff with that block. Okay? So you can see here the issue is that kernel thread 2 is causing the problem by acquiring the global lock, found B, and then now is waiting to acquire B's lock. So kernel thread 2 is blocking everyone. Kernel thread 1 is... Well, if you think about it, it's funny, because kernel thread 1 is only blocking kernel thread 2, but kernel thread 2 is the one with the global lock, so it's blocking everyone else. Okay? Eesh. So, we could do something like this. Acquire global lock, find block B in cache, release the global lock, now we acquire B's lock. Same thing here. Acquire global lock, find block B in cache, release global lock, and then try to acquire B's lock. Okay? So now kernel 3 is allowed to proceed, right? Everybody with me? The problem is now these things can be interleaved in a lot of new ways because... these two things are separate now. We can put stuff in between, stuff that affects block B. Same thing here. We can do stuff between releasing the global lock and acquiring B's lock, and that might change what is in block B, or the place we think block B exists, before we get to it. Okay. So that, you know, so that's what's interesting about this, is that not crabbing in this situation will allow us to achieve much higher concurrency, but we have this new issue we have to be aware of. Okay? Everybody see the issue. I don't want to just blah, blah, blah on and have people lost, because this is like the major concurrency issue people run into in this project. Okay? Okay, so here's another one. Acquire global lock, find block B in the cache, release the global lock. And then kernel thread 2 comes and evicts it. So now we get to block B, and we think it's block B, but we're set because it really isn't. And tests don't pass, and we're up till 5 in the morning trying to figure out why. Okay. That's not happening to anybody, right? So solutions for this. Well, there's a couple of options that people can do, but the easiest one is to just verify that the entry still holds the block when you get to it. Okay? So you acquire the lock on block B, whichever you need, read lock, write lock. You acquire that lock, and then you say, hey, are you still B, by the way? And if it's not, what do you do? Yeah. Yeah, you just go back and try again. Okay. The presumption being you will eventually succeed. Now, we're not asking you to prove that there will be progress, but you know, you just go back and try again. Nobody's saying this is a good file system, by the way. We're just saying it is a working file system. And just like the virtual memory, there's a lot of simplifications that we're accepting here. Okay. Yeah, so that's easy enough. So given this kind of an approach, I think this is a reasonable approach because your hash table will become a central location where there's sort of a global version of what is true, like what is in the cache, what is not in the cache. And then the fact that you can't access, the fact that things may change between going from the hash table to the block, the blocks will also tell you what is true, and then you can go back and ask the hash table again if reality changed out from under you. Okay? All right, let's see, read write locks. Check, I never know if these clocks are correct, but that looks about right. So you probably will need a read write lock. Pintos doesn't have one, and this is on purpose because they want you to get some experience with that stuff. Obviously, you should implement this in terms of other locking primitives, so you get all the benefits of the Pintos locking mechanisms, you know, passively suspending threads and so forth. Okay, you should think about readers and writers. So you have a lock held by readers, another reader shows up, well, maybe you should make that reader wait if there are waiting writers. Okay. Again, this is not something we can really test for, except if you potentially see some tests taking much longer than they should. So that's about the only way that you'll see this show up. More realistically, what will happen is a TA will just look at it and say, oh, this doesn't look very compelling or convincing, and then they'll deduct some points. I believe that there are questions in the design doc that talk about this as well. So you will have to think about this. You're encouraged to think about it. Same thing if you release a lock from a writer. Interestingly, it is possible to bias read-write locks toward writers as well as toward readers. I don't know that the Pintos tests hit this very heavily. And so this is less of a serious issue. The more serious issue is the first one where readers can keep preempting writers and prevent writes from occurring. Okay, so something good to think about, though. Last thing is sometimes people think fairness means granting in the order of request. You really don't need to do that. And in fact, you... I wouldn't be surprised if you could make a faster read-write lock by being unfair to writers for some bounded amount of requests. You know, like, well, a reader can hop in front of a writer for some number of requests, and then we'll finally let the writer go ahead. You know, that might be nice. Okay. So, you know, there would be some interesting things to explore there, but I don't want you to get caught up in this kind of problem. I want you to just implement something that's fair and doesn't starve writers. That's sort of the number one issue here. Okay, there are a lot of details, like everybody and their cat when they implement this part of the assignment, they just get on Wikipedia, search for read-write lock, how do I implement a read-write lock, and follow the algorithm. So not difficult. That's why I don't talk about it too much in here. Let's see. One lock for making operations on the read-write lock atomic, and then a couple of condition variables that synchronize on that lock. That will probably be sufficient. There's also a locking mechanism that I like that uses two locks, two mutexes. One mutex is for exclusivity, and so the writers acquire that one directly, and then readers acquire another one that's not used by the writer, and then they can look at some lock state to tell if there's a writer or if they can go ahead, like if there's multiple readers already. Okay, that one's biased toward readers, so you have to be careful with it. But anyway, you can think about that kind of stuff. State variables, current mode, read locked or write locked, who's waiting, and blah, blah, blah. Okay. One thing about this is that condition variables are freaking awesome, and if you haven't done very much with condition variables, you should definitely look into them. Condition variables require a lock, they synchronize on a lock, and then they allow you to queue up waiting threads for a condition to become true. That's why they're called condition variables. And then you have an option to either wake one or wake everybody. And so typically with a condition variable, if it's a writer, then you wake up one. And if it's a reader, then you wake up everybody because everybody gets to proceed. Okay. So important detail here is that you want to check conditions in a loop when you're doing when you're using condition variables, because somebody can always beat you to the punch, right? You get waken up because you're told, hey, the condition you waited for was true, and so you wake up and you're ready, but you haven't gotten scheduled yet, and somebody else preempts you and gets to the thing before you do, and now the condition is false. So you need to make sure that you wait in a loop. This is like 100% universally true. I should be careful about saying stuff like that. But in all the work that I've ever done involving like POSIX condition variables or Java condition variables or the ones we roll in CS24 where you kind of manually do it with semaphores, you always need to wait in a loop. This is just kind of a universal thing with concurrency. Okay? Questions? So yeah, this was like the hand wavy, you can make a read-write lock. For real, go for it. Okay, read ahead and write behind. So you have to support these things. The whole premise here is that when a process reads sector n, you need to prefetch sector n plus 1. You should not make the process wait. You should just do it in the background. Okay, why would that be? Well, focusing on sequential access, a very common access pattern, but not universal. And probably is a terrible idea to just always do this. You'd want your system to be self-tuning and notice, hey, this person's not accessing this file sequentially. Maybe I won't do read ahead. But again, this is a requirement for the Pintos lab. Right behind, okay? Periodically, you want to go through your file system cache and look at dirty blocks and queue up writes for them. So that's pretty straightforward. And remember that when you're writing it back to disk, now it's no longer dirty, so you need to clear the dirty bit for it. And the idea being that the OS will be more robust when it comes to unexpected crashes. Now, for Pintos, we don't care because we do not test robustness. We do not kill Pintos mid-run and then check to see how good it was doing. So again, this is something that we'll check by inspection, not by testing. And yeah, you'll probably have enough unexpected crashes and they'll probably do unspeakable things to your OS already. So don't have to worry about that. Okay. The only thing that I'll say here as a little aside is that you will need shutdown processing to make sure you write back all dirty blocks at shutdown. That's really key, especially the way that the Pintos tests work, where they will run tests, shut down, restart, and check the OS. Make sure it's okay. So while this will help you a little bit, you still need to do the shutdown processing to write any dirty blocks back to disk. Okay. So these need to happen in the background. And so there's a really common approach that I totally recommend, which is just have some dedicated kernel threads that take care of this for you. Okay. So when the file system starts up, you spin up a read-ahead kernel thread. You spin up a write-behind kernel thread. And they just take care of these things using the other abstractions you will have already created for the file system cache problem solved. Okay, you don't even need to worry about it. Okay, so read ahead service. Like I say, you have a kernel thread that reads a shared queue. Okay, again, you have linked lists. You could just have a single lock guarding that linked list, because presumably you can always append something to the linked list without blocking on anybody, so you're not having a fixed size linked list. You're just, you know, what would be the size? I mean, if you have 64 blocks and you have 64 reads, then that would be another 64 blocks that would be queued up in this queue. So this is not going to grow, and you'd need that lock to make sure the linked list is manipulated properly. But anyway, you just go ahead and dump stuff in the queue when you need to read it ahead, and then all the kernel thread does, okay, so like I say here, the process reads sector N, the kernel thread executing in the kernel on behalf of the process just throws N plus 1 into the queue. And then the read ahead thread would just see these things, so it would continue to ask for stuff, and this is another place where a condition variable would be really nice. Is there something in the queue? And then it can just sit and look at the queue until it's empty and then wait on the condition variable again. Okay, so it just says, hey, I got a request for N plus 1, and it just issues a read. And then that automatically loads it into the file system cache. Okay, so this becomes really simple. You just look, you know, get stuff from this queue and issue a read against it. Okay, everybody got that? But that's why I say this is pretty easy implementation once you have the rest of your infrastructure implemented. Right behind, kernel thread spun up. And so basically what it does is it sleeps for some amount of time, let's say a second. I can't remember what the suggested interval is in the assignment. But basically what it does is wakes up, scans through everything, and just writes back any dirty block. Okay, and then it would obviously make it clean. So that's nice and simple too. This one definitely doesn't require a global lock. It could just lock each block in sequence when it's getting ready to write it out. Okay? All right, so that's easy enough. Any questions about these things? All right, let's see. So extendable files. This actually, there's two more important topics to talk about, so we'll see if we get done in time. But extendable files are pretty challenging. And like I say here, you do need two things to implement this properly. One is a free space map, which already exists, but the initial version allocates contiguous extents. You may want to change that to allocate individual sectors. Like, give me the next available sector. Give me the next available sector. That's what the solution implementation does. And most student implementations do that as well. Okay, and a more sophisticated inode structure for specifying where the data is, because the current version just says this is where it starts and this is how long the file is. And so obviously that is probably going to be torn out. You're going to replace that with something else. Okay, so yeah, like I say, feel free to change that up. Yeah, and this is just what I was mentioning before. Free map allocate is the entry point that tries to grab space for a file. Maybe you just want to change that to do one sector at a time using the free space map, and then easy peasy, right? You're done. Again, you'll notice we aren't really focused on making this super efficient. Okay, the file system partition has been specified to never be larger than 8 megs, which is great. No file can be larger than 8 megs. So that'll also help. Okay. That means that you basically have to support 16K sectors in a file at max, right? So because of that, you can easily look at a couple of these things and figure out how large they'll be and how big you want to design things, and especially your indexing structure. Okay. So free space map can be up to 2 kilobytes because that's how many kilobytes you need to store 16K bits. Let's see, file inodes must be able to index up to 16K sectors. And the requirement of the assignment is multi-level indexing. You could just create a linked list of indexes. That would get a big deduction. Okay, so you need to do some kind of multi-level indexing. Let's see. The file, the free space map is interesting because the free space map is also a file all by itself. Again, you could always allocate a fixed size file for this, and that would be perfectly fine. But its inode is actually hard coded. So free space map is always at inode 0, or inode at index 0. Okay? And there's a definition for where that thing appears. So pretty much, this is really straightforward. You don't really have to do much to it. In fact, you may not do anything to it. Okay? Besides changing the allocate to hand back individual sectors as opposed to contiguous regions. Inode. So what is an inode? This is just the index node that also holds metadata. And the inode typically occupies multiple non-contiguous sectors. Now, what we mean by that is that the root of the inode thing will always be one sector, and that's what directory entries can refer to and so forth. But it may then link to other things in the indexing structure. And so that's why we say that it may occupy multiple non-contiguous sectors, because if you consider the inode to be all the indexing data, then it'll almost certainly spill out. Okay? So here's the thing. Inode.c is a little bit bewildering at first to people because they see that there's an inode thing and then an inode disk thing. Inode disk is the data structure that corresponds to what is stored in the sector. So its size is 512 bytes. It should continue to be that size. And inode is the in-memory representation. So the data from inode disk is unpacked into inode. Or probably a better way of thinking of it is inode is the stuff that we don't store. Like if you have any locks to govern appending, or if you have other details in the inode, then those are things that you don't want to write to disk. Inode disk has all the stuff that you do want to write to disk. Okay. So yeah, inode has an inode disk member, which again you may be confused by at first, but you'll probably throw it out because what you can do is you'll remember the sector number, the logical sector number on the device that that disk block is in, and then what you can do is you can actually just look up against the file system cache. Hey, give me the block for this. I'm sorry. Give me the data for this block, and then you'll get something back from the cache, and then you could just cache that pointer into an inode disk star to access the stuff in it. Okay. Again, pretty common approach. So you'll see that the inode structure itself may lose that inode disk member and start looking it up more dynamically. Or maybe you won't. I mean, but anyway, you'll have to figure out the operations for interacting with the file system cache. Okay, questions? All right. Like just mentioning this, you might have a multi-step operation and you might need to acquire a read lock or a write lock on a sector, and then you get back the pointer, you do junk to it, and then you unlock it at the end. You may have a sequence of operations like that. Let's see, ext2-like. Well, so that means that you have direct nodes, single indirect nodes, double indirect nodes, and thankfully no triple indirect nodes. Who wants to deal with that? Since a direct node can only store 512 bytes, and then you figure out how many of those you can fit in there, you can get up to 64 kilobytes. And not even that, because you have to have space for metadata. So you're definitely not getting up to 8 megabytes by doing that. And I believe that you may be able to get up to it just using single indirect nodes, but I can't remember. I could be wrong on that point. But the suggestion is that you want to use as few of these things as possible. If you decide to do ext2, you'll need some number of single indirect nodes and some number of double indirect nodes, and then that gets you up to over 8 megs. Okay. I'm not going to tell you how many. But you'll need some number. And this is one option. You are certainly not required to do ext2. If you want to do just a fixed depth index that's fixed for all nodes in the indexing structure, that's totally cool. Just make sure it's multi-level and it's not just some analog for linked lists, because then you'll lose points. Okay? So that's pretty easy. That's straightforward to do. Yes.
What do you mean analog to linked lists?
You just basically, I'm trying to think, because honestly I can't think of the way that somebody might end up doing this, but if you have an index node, and then that chains to another index node that indexes into stuff, and then that chains to another index node that indexes, and that's how you handle scaling. That would be a linked list, but I can't think of how you would come up with something that was similar to that and not multi-level index. So, but crazier things have been submitted. So I've seen a few in my time. I just can't remember because the last time I recall, because I haven't been grading for a few years because of TAs. And so the last time I saw this was probably 3 or 4 years ago, thankfully. Okay. So I'm just making sure that you want to make sure you do an index, a multi-level index, I mean. Okay, you have a couple of approaches. I don't know that I'm going to spend too much time on this. Just keep in mind that there's various ways of doing this. You have some implementation choices when you do this. And I would probably do the second way, personally. But plenty of people do the first way without any problems. And just some indexes are special. Okay. Okay, let's see. File extension. I want to make sure I talk about this. It has to be an atomic operation, and this is sort of the... we're going to go a few minutes over time. Sorry, everybody. But anyway, you have to keep the metadata and the data in sync, or else you'll get into trouble. And so you need some kind of locking mechanism in the inode to govern extension. Now, the challenge about this is that you need to make sure reads and writes within the file's extent are still properly concurrent. And so you have to be careful about how you manage this lock. Okay. Remember that files only grow. So basically, I will either be inside the file access or I will be extending. Those are sort of the two options. I won't ever have a situation where I think I'm writing within and suddenly discover that I'm extending the file again because somebody shrank it. Okay. So you have to look at the size. So this is nice. This is a simplification since we don't support shrinking. So two main choices. One is to always lock the extension lock. Check the length. See if I'm extending or not. If I'm not, I'm good. If I am, then well, I'm holding the lock already, so I do my extension. Okay. So this is a little bit annoying, and so you have to be careful about this. It does reduce concurrency. I would just be really careful because of this issue. If you have multiple extenders trying to extend a file, then that's going to block concurrency on accesses within the file. Okay. So another option is to use double check locking. Again, I don't know that I would apply a penalty for people not doing this because it's kind of a challenging technique, but it is a great opportunity to see it in action. Check the current write position, see if we're past the node's length. We might be extending the file, but we don't know yet. So you acquire your lock, and then you check again. Okay. So you do your file extension, release your lock, and get out. Otherwise, if you get down here, you know you're writing to the interior, so you can proceed. Okay. So basically, you only acquire the lock when it looks like you might be extending. Everybody got that? Now, there's this giant obvious risk to this, and you should always think about this when it comes to double-check locking. Got these two accesses. A suitably clever compiler may decide, oh, well, I'll just put that in a register. And then when I have the second access to it, I'll just look at the register value. Well, now you have a problem. Okay. So, basically, the solution that I would apply is to use a volatile for this, or barrier it. I can't remember if this acquire lock thing enforces a barrier. You might want to check it, but you know, using a volatile will avoid a lot of issues anyway. Okay, so that's the big issue with file extension. Are there any questions about double check locking? All right, let's see what else we think about this. Oh, yeah, so you need to think about the steps. I'll just say this because you can figure this out. This is not the hardest part of this assignment. You have to do all these things when you extend the file. Update the file's length metadata, write the data into the file itself, update the file's inode structure with the new sectors, and release the file extension lock. Think about the order that you do these things so that other people doing double check locking will see things at the right time and in the right place and the right way and everything.
Okay.
So you'll have to just think about that a little bit. Yeah, this is just to guard the write extension. You don't want people reading inside that write extension before it's done. That's another part of the assignment guidelines, as they say the extension should complete and then you should see the data in it. Reads against that space, I can't remember what it says exactly, but you can read it. It'll tell you exactly what to do. Okay, directories, I'm not going to talk about this much because we don't have time. Root directory is at its own inode, sector 1. Remember, sector 0 is the free map. Sector 1 is the root directory. Directory entries, you just basically extend them to have a type saying, is this a file or is it a special kind of file that stores directory information? Okay, directories in Unix are files as well. That's why they have a size when you do an ls-l. Okay? They just are specially interpreted by the file system. Okay? Let's see, what else? Yeah, there are concurrency requirements. One of the things that is kind of annoying is global collections of open directories tend to become bottlenecks. So again, you need to think about how you want to synchronize this stuff because you don't want to get a global directory lock that becomes a bottleneck for everything. Okay? And I'm afraid that's all I have time to say about that. Let's see, in-use files. I don't think Pintos Project 6, it wants you to keep track of the current directory, but it doesn't. It's agnostic as to whether you prevent deletions of the directory or you allow deletions of the directory, which tells me there's no tests on it. Okay, so you'll have to think about those things as well. Just pick the thing that's easiest because it's going to be hard enough. Okay, let's see. That's basically it. And yeah, that's just the make sure you ask for help because, again, Michael and Bobby have done a good job on all of these things when they had to implement them, so they'll have a lot of insights that they can share with you. And I might be able to help as well, having the solution implementation to look at. Okay, any questions? All right, thank you, and I'm sorry that it's been over.